For the past 3 months, we've been taking an opportunity every weekday on prime time here in NewsX to get you some of India's best entrepreneurs, people who are coming up in their field, some well-established thinkers, economists, to come and ask and answer one basic question. What do we do as Team India to fix the situation we are in and to chart a path for what happens in this big ship in which all of us are sitting? Let us get started with yet another vibrant episode of this conversation, which has been the longest one on television this year. Joining us on the broadcast today, we have Ms. Niharika Barik Singh. She's Secretary, Department of Health and Family Welfare in the government of Chhattisgarh. Mr. Vipul Agarwal, co-founder of UNLU. Mr. Harsh Agarwal, CEO of Shout Me Loud. We also have with us Ms. Sukmani Sadana. She's a creative entrepreneur. And Mr. Nachiket Dave, who is an advocate and, as always, the editor-in-chief of Business World, Anurag Batra, joining us on the broadcast. Anurag, set up this conversation for us.
That economy and business is important, and the debate between lives and livelihood is ideally shouldn't be there, because lives must be saved and so must be livelihood. So this conversation is about livelihood. Let me ask you why. Start by asking Ms. Singh, when does she see the business and economy coming back? What is her opening comments on the economic stimulus? How does she see the business environment improving? And most importantly, when will the demand be back? Ms. Singh, you'll have to unmute yourself. Yes.
Hi, good evening.
So I was asking you, when do you think the economy will be back on track? When will we be fully in bloom?
That's a very difficult question worldwide. Everybody is just assuming to know the answer, but nobody knows the answer. But I see that a lot of economic activities are happening. It's limping back to normalcy. Right? Normalcy is not the right word, but we are coming towards somehow, you know, calibrated normalcy. Sectors are opening. People are also gearing up to face that. Earlier, if you recall in February or March, they were business establishments had just shut down. Hospital, private hospitals, clinics had shut down. And people had somehow thought that the COVID will just vanish in a couple of days and they'll open their businesses. Now they've come to terms with the fact that we probably have to live with COVID. So everybody is coming around with newly equipped skills to protect themselves and opening up the economy.
Okay, but tell us from the position where you are, what are the sectors you see coming back faster than others? Also, the hotels in Delhi have opened today. That means at some stage, large gatherings, at least mid-sized gatherings, whether formal business events or social events, will be allowed with some kind of caveats over the next 1 week to 2 weeks. Tell us, what's your outlook? Because these events itself are a multiplier for economy. You know, they give jobs downstream to people who fabricate, to the hotels, to an artist that would perform at the event, to the MC that hosts the event. So, you know, it has its own kind of a multiplier economy or a trickle-down effect. So give us a sense of where we are headed.
What I see on television, the hotels before opening have adopted new practices, social distancing, sanitizing, checking their guests before coming in. A very precautious attempt to open up the economy and or the hotels and everything. That's going to be useful. In a smaller town also, I find that hotels are opening. People are going out to eat. The hotels are also very, very cautious about it. So good sign. That also instills a sense of confidence in people that things are going to be normal. What I see in the pandemic is, more than anything else, there's a lot of psychological impact of the pandemic, which has effects on mental health. So these gradual opening ups of hotel normalcy will probably give stability to the mental health factor in our society. And if you ask me which are the sectors which are going to do well, definitely pharmaceutical sector is going to do well, medicine or the medical equipment sector is going to do very well.
Thank you so much for those opening comments. Let me bring the entrepreneurs, some who are professionals, and I call them creative entrepreneurs, into the conversation. Harsh, the Prime Minister announced the economic package almost 4 months back. Has the economic stimulus had impact on the ground? If yes, how? If not, do you see it having impact?
Right. I believe it was a good step towards bringing some relief to the already an economy which is heading toward recession. So it definitely gave a relief for the time being. But it will have a longer term impact, because the biggest thing is the purpose of economic stimulus was that people actually go out and spend the money, right? But in this COVID situation, we are at the same time, we are encouraging people to stay home, don't go out for shopping, and shops are closed as it is. So the impact that was supposed to be seen was not seen. That was number one. Number two, it also, we might have heard about Robin Hood situation where like people are spending a lot of money on the stock market. And because of, and that is also an outcome of the stimulus.
No wonder the stock market is booming. There is a disconnect between the real street and the Fleet Street. It doesn't mirror what is the reality on the ground.
So, True that. I mean, and that is very unfortunate, and perhaps something that people should be aware of, that a big wave might be coming next. The second wave is something we are expecting. We are already seeing that in the ground, but what we are not seeing is officially there is no word about that second wave is here. Saying that, the third part is the banks. So government has also, when they open their machine for the to print more money, so that people should be able, so the bank lent more money to the people, which is something which we have not seen so far, which is another red flag. So saying that, on the ground, the stimulus has had not the impact that we wanted to see. In fact, it will have a little worse impact in the months to come, because there is no existing relief that we are seeing. The businesses are trying to survive. They are trying to run. Are they in profit or will they be in profit is something which time will decide.
Thank you, Harsh. We'll come back to you. Thank you for your opening comment. Mr. Dave, you're a legal professional. You work with businesses. You work with entrepreneurs. Will we see commercial litigation going up in the next few months? And, do you see large law firms letting go people because economic activity is weak? Not many mergers acquisitions are happening. Not many investments are happening. So tell us, what is your outlook, one, on commercial litigation growing? And second, do you think the law firms will need to right size to deal with the economic situation?
Yeah, so for the first thing, I think commercial litigations will suffer a little bit of hit, because the courts have been closed, the business have been shut. So it's very difficult even for the clients to approach the lawyers and invest the money so far as litigation is concerned, because litigation, as you know, is not a very cheap expense. It is an expense which is quite much. So I think since the businesses have been shut and the economies and the businesses of the various business sectors have also been taken for a gross hit. And so I think it will take a little bit time for the litigation to come back to where it was left.
A little bit time. 3 months, 6 months?
I think 6 months. I think ideally it may be 6 months, 6 to 7 months, at least 6 to 7 months, because till the time, I mean, the business comes back into rolling. And since after, only when the business starts to roll, that's when they will start to probably go and think and enter to try to go for the rights, or maybe try to assert their rights. But till that happens, I think they are firstly, the primary focus of them will be to set the business rolling, to just set the ball rolling from where they had left in the early months of March or maybe February. So till that happens, I don't see much of litigation happening so far as the commercial side is concerned. And so far as the legal firms is concerned, I think you're right. They might have to downsize a little, because the legal firms also have huge expenses, because hundreds of lawyers working and hundreds of other capital costs. So I think all the legal firms have by and large have actually made a short pay cut to the lawyers. I don't know. I mean, it all actually boils down to what firm has cut what amount of money. But there has been a pay cut, there has been a haircut for each and every legal firm, all the lawyers working legal firm, maybe 10%, 20%, 30%, maybe more also. And it all depends for how long this haircut remains. I've been told that it's been there for almost 3 months, and it might stop probably by say like October, November. I mean the fees or the salaries which have been generally given to the partners of law firms or the employees of firms will again resume. So for the time being, yes, we all are facing a hit. And it's a tough fence for everybody. Let's hope and pray that we can just get out of this more faster, quicker, and in the best way possible.
Okay, Mr. Dave, we'll come back to you. Sukmani, you're a creative entrepreneur, as I call people who host events, who are performers, who are actors, you do your own show. The entertainment industry in the last 5.5 months has suffered a lot, like the travel industry, like the hospitality industry. Now, tell us, while shooting has resumed in some form or the other, cinemas are still closed, the content is not getting created as it used to. How has it impacted professionals like you? Give us a sense of how do you see the economic impact of the lockdown on your community?
First, I want to thank you for having me on the show, and Rishabh, and hi everyone who's here. It has made a huge impact for sure. But having said that, I feel like now that when we're talking, the better times are starting now. I think about 3 to 4 months back, the situation was really, really bad. And for me, I see my industry going from not to worse, but it's getting better by the day. So the shoots have started. Also, I must mention to you the 3 months when there was a lockdown actually was a great time for writers. I'm a writer and an anchor. So at one point where my emceeing and anchor literally came to nil, because events is the last thing that's going to take place, because that's a huge gathering. So any sort of big events or glamour or, you know, awards or anything of that sort, is I don't see it happening for the next 6 months, maybe even a year. Also, there's smarter ways that people have discovered of hosting events. We have live events which are going on right now. And you have anchors and MCing who are doing that even live. So people are, you know, it's like when you're really pushed to that limit and you have to really think creatively as to how your life should continue and the remuneration should keep coming up. We all have come up with solutions for our careers as an option B to work from home. So, but writing, if you ask me, was great for the last 3 months, because I think that's when all the producers and directors started knocking on the door of the writers saying, hey, there's a lockdown going on, you know. You guys are the ones who can actually pick up your laptop because you're home and just keep typing. We have this concept, let's develop that. If you have any concept, you develop that. So I think it was a great time, touch wood, knock on the wood. I was very lucky. I was working throughout. But of course, it's taken a big hit. But shoots have resumed now, though they're smaller shoots, 30, 40 people, maximum 150 people. Precautions are being taken. But I feel like the ones who would probably feel the hit would be the big banners. The big banners which make big films which are larger than life and humongous on scale, war films, you know, films which are huge in terms of shoot and the number of people required, will not be able to resume for a while to come right now. But films and concepts and web series which are high on concept, even writers and producers and directors are trying to think of concepts where 5 people can be in a flat. And it can be concept driven, and it can be a great concept, and we can shoot it like that, and we can edit it quickly, and we can even release it on a Netflix or an Amazon. So yes, but at the same time, I don't see cinemas opening anytime soon. I don't think they should open anyway. It's not even advisable. So at the same time, Anurag, when a theater has taken that hit back, at the same time, digital has picked up. So the industry has somewhere formed an equilibrium. We've never seen these amount of films and web series come on Netflix, Amazon, Hotstar, Z, the way we're seeing it now. It's pumping. So people are churning material. So it's fine if it's not going to release in a theater, but I don't think that makes much of a difference, because your remuneration is still coming from other sources.
Thank you. There is a kind of a silver lining in the dark cloud, and you rightly said, for individual players where costs are less, it is much easier than large players who have a lot of money invested in films that were either halfway shot or were going to be released. I think the worst for the film industry is not yet over, because the cinema halls are not open. So the industry will only come out of its hibernation, if I may say, only when the cinema halls are up, because OTT are good, but they are not the same as going to a cinema, both from a cinematic experience and from a revenue standpoint. There's a whole lot of revenue that is kind of getting compromised. Mr. Vipul Agarwal, you're an entrepreneur, and there's one real worry. Me and Rishabh have been talking on the show about startups, entrepreneurs, founders who are holding up for the last 5 months, but their revenues have gone down. They've not been able to raise capital. Do you see a lot of startups shutting up, shutting shop in the next couple of months? Harsh already said that he envisaged the next 2-3 months to be tougher than the last 5 months. What is your view, Vipul Agarwal?
Like Harsh, I think taking care of a lot of points where he talked about the stimulus and how it's coming to the ground, but with the banks, like, it's something which is stuck at, and we are not seeing a lot of disbursements happening, at least on those sides. Okay, with the startups, I think it's a kind of new wave. So if you had seen the 2008 crisis that brings Airbnb, or if you had seen that 2010 strike that brings Uber. So every such pandemic which comes up, every such thing which comes up, it gives rise to a lot of new opportunities. Okay, and as also Sukhmani covered that how the entertainment industry been hit. Okay, you had seen a lot of people moving to the OTTs, and even for a long, long period of time, there was no work in the industries. Okay, so one thing which is very amazing, which is happening, that the people have to move to the micro payments thing, which we had seen happening in the different part of the startups. Okay, so that's one thing. I think that's amazing opportunity where a lot of startups going to thrive, like us, where we connect our fans from the celebrities and they get to get the micro payments happen, which keeps them thriving, which keeps them close to the fans for the time. At the same time, things like Chingari and all, which comes up, which will actually cover the part of the TikTok, which keeps people again close to their celebrities. Okay, so all these things will start thriving in these times. At the same time, I think one more thing which had been very important for the investors possibly in these times is that how much revenues you are making. So if you see pre-COVID, or I think a couple of years back, the situation was that keep kept on growing and revenues were not much in focus. But I think in the last few months, people had realized that how important it's to have the revenues. Okay, not just for the sake of growing, but also to sake of surviving. If something comes up tomorrow for 5 months, 6 months, so how many companies are there who can actually survive without raising more capital, and where the investors are not willing to take more risk? So it'll be an eye-opener, I would say, I think, for Indian economy.
But you're right. One of the big mindset change that has happened in the last 5 months, we've started to realize that costs have to be lower than revenue. It seems so basic, but for many years, at least last 5 years, how much money to raise and what was your GMV at pass-through mattered, not profitability. So I think it's a significant mindset change. What I also want to ask you is that the revenue of influencers has also been impacted because the brands have taken a pause. Now that the IPL is around the corner, now that Diwali is around the corner, do you see better days for influencers?
Exactly. Like the moment COVID happens, you know, a lot of brands sit back and they start thinking how they want to go ahead. So in first 3-4 months, there was nothing happening for the influencers, at least on the higher side of the table. Okay, with even IPL coming up, you must have seen a lot of news where Future, I think, backed out today as a sponsor, and Vivo backed out. And it's a amazing, like, it's a huge loss happening for the IPL this year. Like, they are losing around more than 50% of the revenues. So that way, I think it's still not clear for a lot of brands how they're going to market themselves. Okay, and is it even right time to market themselves or sponsoring with such a huge amount of money? Okay, which obviously decreased down a lot of money from which the influencers were earning, because a lot of money to the influencers was coming from the brands. They never had any other resources apart from having all these shows where they were acting in, or apart from these big payments coming from the brands, like on a monthly basis or the bi-monthly basis. So if you see, so all these micro payments, all these people are relying on the major payments, okay, like the lakhs of checks which comes either from the brands or from the OTTs or the shows or movies, okay. So I think now it's a time where they also realized that there's a need of the micropayment happening, where something keeps coming on a daily basis, something keeps coming regularly instead of what's happening. So yes, it got impacted a lot, like the money that they used to make earlier, it's much way down than what it was. And I think initially when the TikTok was there, so a lot of digital apps actually came up who started marketing and spending a lot, because they were taking the time of the user which was spending on TikTok, which was spending on Instagram. So because of that time, a lot of digital apps do come up. They started marketing themselves, which gives a bit of hype. But after that Chinese thing happened, where a lot of apps got banned, I think that marketing budget also went down. Okay. And if you see, I think what I had noticed, like in the pandemic, things had changed drastically. So though we are still in the pandemic, but the behavior from the first couple of months, where the people are spending a lot of time on TikTok, a lot of time on house party or the amazing apps, like whatever comes up, they had moved out from there.
Well, Ludo.
Ludo, yeah.
You know, so things that
they drastically moved out. Yeah, and moved into cooking, moved into health. Okay, so the transformation happening even during the pandemic. Okay, so how the next 90 days going to be for India? I think that's not going to matter a lot.
Okay.
But how we are going to thrive in the next 1 year as an economy, I think going to make a lot of difference.
Yeah, the question, so, the, you know, the mood question then becomes, guys, is, you know, is the transformation happening or is it happened? Let's rope in Harsh Agarwal before I get Ms. Singh back into this conversation. Harsh, is the transformation happening or is it happened? Both with, you know, existing businesses, startups, are there still people trying to figure out models, or have the models been tried and tested and we know what works, what doesn't work?
Right. So now, since we have some data in terms of, like, you know, how the COVID has impacted overall situation, so the transformation has started happening. And especially, I really reckon with our Prime Minister wording of Atmanirbhar Bharat, because the only way, there are certain industry that we are seeing which is getting really good bump because of the COVID. One of them is self-care. And as Vipul has rightly said, the cooking industry, the self-care industry, they are seeing bump because...
You know, rather than calling it that, I would call it the do-it-yourself industry. Because, you know, today restaurants have become cloud kitchens who are sending do-it-yourself cooking kits where your favorite restaurant is in your home. So really, it's the do-it-yourself economy that's kind of rising.
Yeah. We are seeing a lot of mini chef coming out in the societies who are actually distributing food and making money from there. Another industry that we should definitely pay attention to is the online tech education. Yeah. That industry is something which is getting the biggest benefit out of this. Not only from the school education, which is, like, you know, about 1.2 billion children who are actually
question is, Harsh, you know, how much is this temporary or is it here to stay? Because eventually, maybe a year later, schools will open. I mean, we can't be in a situation where universities and schools are permanently closed, right? So does this stay? Does the resilience stay?
Right. So right now, this is definitely a temporary measure, but it will have a permanent impact. The way we see the education, the way we do things will definitely be changed as we move ahead.
Okay, so it's going to have permanent impact. Let me get Ms. Niharika Singh back into this conversation. Ma'am, let's look at it from the perspective, you know, of something that you have to deal with in terms of e-governance. How much is your workflow life changed in the past 5 months, and how much of it is worthwhile for you and your team to retain, or how much is temporary?
See, I am Secretary of Health in Government of Chhattisgarh. For me, it really didn't matter because we had to work in our flesh and blood on the ground. So for us, E definitely was a part, but not a major part, like education or any other field that you were discussing right now. Yes, we moved to teleconsultancy in terms of some of the diseases. We moved to dispensing medicine through an online portal and sending messengers through our government agencies. But we had to work on the ground. We had to do contact tracing, we had to meet people, we had to make hospitals, we had to make systems in place to handle COVID, we had to establish virology lab. So it was a very, very big task.
That's an important reminder that the real world exists. But, you know, Niharika ji, in this context, you know, the basics of having more people who are used to doing teleconferencing or these kind of online meetings, or more people with, you know, with access to broadband, who are, you know, signing themselves up. Is that going to be a permanent change? Because even the way government is working right now, you know, we've had one of these teleconference app guys have just won a 1 crore contract because they won a competition. So moving away from tendering processes to competitions, are you seeing this happening?
It is definitely going to happen. See, you and I cannot expect COVID to just vanish out of this world. Even if we find a vaccine, even if we know how to deal with it, even if medicines come, COVID is going to exist in our disease burden of the society.
Correct.
Like swine flu, at one point of time, we all didn't know how to handle swine flu. But today, throughout the year, we handle swine flu in most of our hospitals, most of our city, kasbas, chote shahar, everywhere. So similar way, COVID will also remain in the community disease burden, and we will learn to handle that. So certain amount of e-learning or e-handling will remain. We cannot just wish away all the cautions that we right now are taking one day just because vaccine has arrived or medicines have arrived.
Okay, so I'm not going to ask you to predict when we're getting the vaccine. Now let's get Sukhmani back into this conversation. Ms. Sadhana, you know, the conversation that, you know, Anurag and I keep on having, I've been having this for now 3 months, is that while alternatives are being found, and especially in an industry like yours, are those alternatives still profitable, or are they still stopgap arrangements? Is people just, you know, staying in the limelight until something better comes along?
Well, if you ask me, it's exactly what I think, I don't know who mentioned that earlier, is that you've just got to make peace with the fact that whatever's coming your way right now, you've just got to grab it and you know, it, that's your bread and butter. So we can't really be picky right now, if that's the question that you're asking, and I hope I'm answering it correct. It might be smaller on a smaller scale, but you've got to, and I'll tell you one more thing more than anything else, as anchors or writers or producers or directors, what you do not want to do is disappear. You don't want to just, especially as an actor, if you are just bumming around for 1 year while there was a lockdown and pandemic going on, when the world picks up, they're going to take the best of people, right? The ones who are still mentally sane and who are physically fit and who have still practiced and nourished and all that stuff. So you don't want to just disappear. So what happens is smaller shoots, smaller projects, whatever's coming your way, you just want to be seen. It's very important for an actor to be seen. So people remember you, the recall value is there. Same goes for writers, same goes for anchors. Yeah. I started my own Instagram live show just because I was scared that if when the world opens up after 1 year, will I be able to socially interact with people? Will I even remember how to act anymore? Will I even remember how to MC? Will I have stage fright suddenly?
Yeah, because it's being there. It might not be paying you the same amount, but it's being there. It's being visible.
Yes, I think it's important to just keep the wheel churning. You've got to just keep moving. So of course the money is maybe 1/10. Anyway, the industry's been famous for always saying ki paise nahi hai. So you know, even when the economy is
great, speaking to journalists.
So imagine a situation like this. So the first thing you hear is
trust me, we know paise nahi. I can't say that to the lawyers, can I?
Exactly.
all my friends who were lawyers became fancy people, and I wish I could put my English to better use in a different domain like a courtroom. Although we journalists get accused of running courtrooms these days. Mr. Dave, let me pick up on that thought. You know, limbo. It's not just people in industry, professionals, but you have currently people in school, people coming out of college. There has been a shock limbo which is there, right? Where you just don't know what happens next. You don't know what the model coming up next is. How much of it is for people to have a get-go attitude and say, listen, I can't wait for something to happen. I have to make something happening. For example, if you're a class 12 student and you wait 4 months for your results or 5 months for your results, or if you want to give NEET or, you know, some other examination, you almost lose a year. How do we change the object of people getting up and saying, no, we have to fill the time with something more productive?
See, I agree to what you're saying.
Vipul Agarwal, why don't you come in? What's here to stay, Vipul Agarwal? What is a temporary measure, and what is fundamentally going to be different in how we live our lives next year? Vipul, if you can hear us. Vipul, if you can hear me, question I was trying to ask was what is fundamentally changed, what's here to stay, and what is only a temporary thing?
Like everything what is happening right now, I think a lot of things are seen temporary, like where the addiction of, let's say, moving a lot on the digital and spending a lot of screen time. Okay, so that's something which is obviously going to get away. Apart from that, I think a lot of test happens towards that, how the work from home things happening. Okay, so since there was always a speculation that whether that work from home gonna come out and take over about all those offices and things. Okay, so with this COVID, when the moment it came in, so the moment people are experiencing it, so I think the pros and cons are coming out. Okay, so that's one thing which is possibly a big test which is right now happening. And I think with my personal experience, I think the office need is going to come back again. Okay.
Okay.
So that's been one. Like apart from that, I think a lot of behavior is right now happening as per the COVID is going on. So people are sitting at home and the behavior is following that way. But the moment they're gonna come out, the moment COVID is going away from their life, okay, and the moment they're gonna step out and do all those normal activities, I think a lot of things, like you see the 90%, 80% things going to be what it was pre-COVID. Okay, what's going to happen during COVID, that it's going to give a rise to a lot of industries who had been suffered a lot. Like you see the travel industry who suffered a lot, okay. So I think there are a lot of innovation going to happen in travel, okay, which will make it sustain like from the next COVID or next such pandemic coming in. There are a lot of problems coming in the influencer space, the influencer economy. So the moment you, I think a lot of innovation going to come up where.
Okay, so why don't you specifically speak about that? What is the innovation? Now, what are you guys doing? Is it UNLU, UNLU? How do you guys pronounce it?
UNLU, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So what are you guys doing?
So the point was that as we started, so as even Sukhmani mentioned, that we need to stay close to the fans, okay? As the pandemic is happening, so there's no shows are happening. There is no way I, as a celebrity, can even come out and talk to my fans. So it's very much needed, because I don't want after 1 year or 1.5 year, the moment my show gonna come out, people don't even remember me. Okay, or I'll lose the engagement. So there is a need of fan engagement, which arrived a lot. Okay, and there is a need of micro payments, which arrived a lot. There is a need of one different sort of source of payment, which keeps continuing arriving.
Okay, so it boils down to what is taking place in terms of interpretation, that this is right now, and this is investable, because we are running the risk in all of this is that we are seeing in particular domains, you know, take teleconferencing apps, for example, suddenly we are seeing so many of them come up because that's what the need of the hour is. Somebody was telling me Zoom has seen a, you know, 17x, that's 1700% jump in traffic, and we've all shifted to a particular platform. A part of this is, of course, going to stay. Then the question, of course, remains is how much of it comes back, and it comes back to what level? Let me try to see if I can rope in Harsh on the same question. Harsh, how much of what we are seeing right now changes fundamentally, and how much of this is just a stopgap that goes away?
Right. So definitely.
Harsh, you can hear us. Okay, I think I've lost that. I've lost that that linkage with Harsh in just a second. We'll try to come back to it. But the point one was trying to raise was, in a particular context of how much we've seen develop in the past few months, we've had so many conversations that indicate that, look, habits are tough to form, but once they're formed, they're even tougher to break. So all of us have moved into certain new routines. Some of those routines, of course, can be monetized and get converted into revenues for new industries. Some of them are simply going to dissipate, and some of the early movers who have seen a dramatic change taking place.
Yeah, Harsh, go ahead. Would be prepared for the second contingency for similar situation if that happens, and that is going to be interesting to see. And looking back to the thing that how this thing will have impact. So one way to look at it is that in the education sector, a lot of companies have invested heavily on the equipments, on the SaaS products. How are they going to ensure that those investments are not going to impact their overall revenue? And when we talk about all the sector, you know, if financial profitability is one of the factors that no business would let go of.
Okay, Anurag Batra, why don't you just weigh in on this? I mean, some of these things are going to become profitable, opportunities. Some people were just right there, you know, right place, right time. You know, you saw that happen with, you know, demonetization, where you had, you know, particular payment apps were just there and they boomed. Zoom and all have boomed. But competition is now catching up, and some of these habits might stay, but some of the habits will wither away.
Absolutely. Rishabh, we respond to the current environment in terms of how we act.
Okay. All right. You know, I'm losing the connection there with Anurag Batra. I'm just going to take a quick break. We'll fix that. There's also a CWC meeting coming up on the other side. See you in a minute.
Shield hand sanitizer.
Okay, we are back. Let's listen into Anurag. Yeah.
Technology growth, the more is the value of physical touch. It becomes even more premium. That's how I see it. Having said that, Mr. Dave doesn't need to meet me if he needs to discuss a case from Ahmedabad to Delhi. He can discuss the case brief or a Zoom call. But he would still want to meet his associates, business colleagues. So that need won't go. What I wanted to ask Harshan, Harsh, within your business, what are the changes that have come, which are permanent because of COVID, and some that possibly as things improve will change? I want to ask you a very specific question.
Sure. So we are in the business of educating people about how to become their own boss. That is in the form of digital marketing. One very important change that I've seen, like the people who are working in a corporate environment, like people with 6 or 8 years of experience and people are at a very good role, they're understanding that the situation, their job is not secure. And they are all looking for something that they can do at the side, which can become a permanent business for them. And that is the reason I've seen a lot of the number of people who are podcasting, the number of people who are creating their blogging or even a YouTube channel have increased a lot. But at the same time, you know, they're realizing that within 3 months that, okay, this is not something which they can succeed within in a very short span of time. A lot of them are leaving also and looking for something, some better opportunity. And so one very tangible benefit that we have seen, like impact we have seen, is the online courses sales have increased significantly. Yeah. People are willing to learn a lot. People are willing to take action a lot, which is a good sign that people are thinking that.
That we all get. I'm saying, what is the change in your business model? That edutech, reskilling, new skills, buying online courses, all that we know is grown. What have you done to your business, which is fundamentally different from what it was 5 months back?
Sure. We have stopped spending money on the advertising. That's number
That's
one.
That's not good. Let me tell you, there is a saying that you must advertise. You must, in good times, you should advertise, and in bad times, you must. So, you know, there will be a time, and I say it seriously, because the edutech space is growing. There are multiple players in every sub-segment and sub-segment. So you will need to connect with your possible. So it's not if you under-invest, some player is over-investing in advertising and is taking market share away from you. And you know, just because I run a media company,
self-serving at all.
You should take me.
I'll also chime in. Not self-serving at all.
You know, you definitely. Should take me seriously.
Definitely. Thank you for that.
Yes, and can I tell you, edutech players are raising capital. 30% of that capital is going into brand building. It is going into customer acquisition. So it's not that, you know, smaller, mid-sized and large edutech players continue to invest in brand building. And brands, dare I say, will stand out. So it's your time to build your brand, because brands get premium. Why do you buy an iPhone? The same features are in phones that are one-third cheaper. You buy it.
You know, Anuragji, we should convert this show into a business edutech show and, you know, try to market it online. Maybe that's the next step. But Harsh, why don't you take the premise of the question? The premise was, okay, other than your advertising spends, what has changed in business logic, which you feel is here to stay, in fact, might help you become more profitable going ahead?
Right. So what is, I'm talking about the big change that has happened is we are a remote team. And the way we interact with our people have something which has changed a lot. Rather than just focusing on micromanaging, we have started being more empathic toward ensuring that people's mental health is in the check. And there has been situation when people have come up and they say like, hey, Harsh, we are not doing good, or there's something wrong, like, you know, I'm not able to understand. And we actually had to bring expert, medical practitioner expert to help them grow. Now, from somebody who's running a business, I think it's very important to be to keeping a check on their employees, on their team, so that they grow, not just they perform, but they are to be able to bring out the performance in them. You have to take care of all the aspect of that. Okay. So that is another area that has.
Rishabh, I have a different view on it, and you know, we can do a poll around it.
Yeah.
I think, in my view, remote working is overhyped. You know, I would call it flexi working, which is better. And in work from home, the people who used to work well, even without work from home, continue to work well. But the ones that didn't work well before the lockdown don't work, because there's no way you can figure that out. And it's a time when you're a little more compassionate, lenient to your colleagues. So I don't think Ralph, work from home really necessarily increases productivity. That's my view.
No, I agree with the concept.
It's a mindset thing. It's people who are like, you know, self-motivated.
Yeah,
they would do great.
You're bang on. Bang on. Absolutely bang on. And but people who are not, who require to be in an environment away from distractions, and that's each one person is different. Why don't we get in, Mr. Dave, back into this conversation. Mr. Dave, you know, looking at in a pragmatic point of view, before I leave it to Anurag and the rapid fire he's going to do, as a country, seeing a global landscape where, you know, who knows, in, you know, in a few weeks there might be at least some kind of conflict happening in the South China Sea, or, you know, or in the Mediterranean Sea, or for all we know, with China. What kind of factoring does that have to be done? Because our generation hasn't seen these kind of global issues. We've seen Iraq, we've seen Afghanistan, but we haven't seen a global conflict. You know, does it make a business aspect calculation for any of us?
I think it's tough to say on that, because how is going to change our business? How is going to impact our economy? Because right now we are facing this actually throttle because of COVID. So it's very difficult to say right now, because as it is right now, the economies globally have gone for a toss. So right now, the most important thing is to see from the point of view of our own businesses as to how do we stand, where do we stand, and what steps can we take in order to revive the economy and to boost the economy. Because it has been the dream of our Modi ji also, that to make the $5 trillion economy. So that dream also we need to take forward, and then we have to be in the place that we are right now. So I think right now, so far as country like India is concerned, we should, as Mr. Modi just said, we should focus on being actually trying to manufacture more of things in India.
Yeah, okay.
Number two, there to
okay.
be some
okay,
sort
okay.
of
so
like
I'll put capital, that question to you.
Capital, I mean, a capital gain which can come to India. So our focus primarily should be to be able to
okay,
make.
So I'll put
things.
That. I'll put
so
that question
can,
to you.
Sell them
how much
capital influx?
How much?
Because unless there's a capital influx, we're going to find it difficult to actually tide over through this tough situation.
You're absolutely
so
right.
I think there should be a more important capital influx. That's how I would see it. And obviously, there has to be taxation policies which have to be actually lowered down, where people find it even more. I mean, simpler. So as to cope up with the taxation laws. So all this we will see as a nation. I am not aware as to what is going to happen.
Okay.
With the
but is there the is there particularly, Mr. Dave, in your industry? You know, we were interviewing somebody on the panel a couple of days ago. You know, doing, you know, these legal advice apps. In terms of both, in terms of a business, in getting online, in readopting a business model, and both in terms of practice through your virtual hearings, which have been going on. I think courts have opened or are opening in some places, but it's only going to be 4 or 5 hearings a day, which doesn't cover much. So in that regard, how much of a business model on both fronts, both the operational front and the business front, can change?
So basically, see, as a lawyer, not only me, not speaking for myself, but for majority of lawyers, we would be more happy if the courts start in normal physical forms. Because trying to argue a matter over the phone or through virtual hearings is not as simple as what it sounds to be. Hmm. Because as a lawyer, I know that a case may have hundreds and thousands of papers. So while you're showing some paper and while you're trying to rely upon some sort of papers, it becomes very tough. And what happens is, to a lawyer, a client will essentially come to a lawyer's office. He will like to come with his files of papers, wherein he will have to show certain papers. He will place reliance upon certain papers. So unless this all starts in the normal physical form, it will be troublesome for lawyers also. And primarily, see, a lawyer's office is at place A, but the clients come from place B, place C. They would come from towns, villages. So they all like to travel, and not every client is so well versed with this technology.
You're right. It's not.
Lawyers who are high court based, they're happy. But the lawyers who are not high court based, who are trial court based, or maybe the ones who are practicing at lower levels of judiciary, they are not so used to all this technological thing. So for them, it's also troublesome. And as a lawyer, see, I told you a few minutes back that I traveled. I had to travel for the simple reason because the matter which I was doing, the matters had about 3,000 pages, and I had to brief a counsel. So over a Zoom call to make a council understand that how the law stands, okay, or 3,000 pages
okay
to be shown,
important points. Okay. Okay, just stay with me. Sukmani, you know,
yeah,
just let's quickly look ahead, because in the end, you know, we are all in the same boat together.
Hmm.
What do we know? Do we need more creative entrepreneurship? Do we need still stuff some from government coming our way?
Sorry, once again?
Do we need still stuff coming out from government in terms of policy, in terms of reform, in terms of a second tranche of a stimulus, or do we now leave it to creative entrepreneurship?
I think it needs to be a mixture of both, honestly, because beyond the point, being self-sufficient as a country can work, but in the long run, I don't see it happening to 100% accuracy if that's what our government is expecting. For example, there's a whole strata and a percentage of a population that is not in favor of a self-sufficient system. There will be people who will always be interested in importing and in foreign products, foreign form of education, and you can just not dismiss and erase this strata and population of people. They might be sly about it. It's literally like how I know people who are COVID positive, but they're not even telling people that they're positive because they're embarrassed of it and they don't want to be judged. Similarly like that, there will be a bunch of people in our country who would not follow the self-sufficient, let's make in India, buy Indian products policy. It's just
because
happen,
it,
right?
It just might be, you know, cheaper to just, you know, import something from China and, you know, take your 20%. And is this
maybe,
easier?
Maybe yeah, not even that. Maybe they're brand conscious. Maybe they're product conscious. Maybe they're quality conscious. Maybe they're just used to it. Maybe it's
you're,
a
no, you're right. And we have this concept of, you know, whatever comes from abroad, we seem to like it better than if it comes from India. We have this problem.
Giving
here in this
gifts
country
to people. You don't know. You might not want to give a khadi kurta to your friend on a birthday. You might want to give I'm not talking about myself, but there might be people who might want to give a Coach or an LV or a Jimmy Choo bag. What do you do?
Yeah, and until
like
those brands made in India also.
Around the corner, Sukmani, and I'm okay with the khadi kurta. I'm going to tell you that.
I'll send you a fake version of that.
And I've learned all these things after marriage. I'm told a Birkin bag is a big deal. I did not know what that was earlier,
so,
but I do not. I know. I now know.
It's not going to work for your wife. It's just not going to work. And you would probably not tell people about it, but you'll be slyly doing these orders all the time. So like I said, it has to be a balance between the two. I hope that people in India do buy products which are made in India, but I know realistically it's not going to be 100% accurate.
Or maybe we guys need to sit down and figure out how is it that we can create a brand in which people want to sit on wait list for 6-7 years to purchase something. I have friends who are waiting to buy a Tesla. They booked it 4 years ago, still waiting. Probably never going to be sold here in India. Who knows? Anuragji, we got a few minutes left. Rapid fire time.
I want to start with Ms. Singh. We started with you. See, primarily, the economic crisis has come out of a healthcare crisis.
Correct.
And dare I say, the central government and the states have done a reasonably good job at it, considering the scale of our country, considering the uniqueness of our country, considering our resources, you might say. I would say that both the central government and the state governments have done a fairly good job at it. But tell us, my question to you is, you understand, you're a senior bureaucrat, right now you're Secretary Health, but you understand what's happening in the state, you understand what's happening in the country. When do you see the economy coming back? In 6 months, 12 months, 18 months? I know temporarily with Diwali.
Yeah, there might be some sort of recovery during the Diwali period. But the question then becomes is that recovery going to be long lasted? Are we actually going to see Diwali be a game changer? Or is it just going to be only the blip for a couple of months where people have a bit of exuberance and in the end of the thing, it becomes a damn squib as we head back into January and February as well. Well, one of the frustrations of working from home and doing stuff from home is what happens when you lose network connectivity. I'm sure you've experienced that. We've experienced that during the broadcast.
The healthcare workers have been at the core of it. So the healthcare department in every state has played its role in making sure that the infection as well as the fatality is at the least. We salute you. But what is another silver lining in this cloud that you encountered?
I think the amount of health infrastructure that has been created in a very short span in Chhattisgarh, which is quite an infrastructure poor state. We now have ICUs even in the remote part of Bastar. We have in Sukma, Bijapur, if you have heard names of these districts. we have ICUs there, we have high oxygen supply there, HDUs made there. Our doctors have also got trained. We have trained them virtually, online, and other means. They're all trained. So we would be probably better equipped to handle a host of other diseases now.
Fantastic. That's very good news. Quick comment, Twitter-like comment. Vipul Agarwal, economy, when will it come back? 6 months, 12 months, 18 months? Same question to all panelists. Vipul Agarwal, first you.
Like, I can't see even next cycle having amazing, like, lot of responses. So possibly not in next 9 months, 6 to 9 months. It's going to take more than that for sure.
I think it would take more than 18 months. According to World Bank report, technically we are going to see the worst recession after World War II, and we can't take this as a joke. So
this is clearly the most pessimistic panel we've had, which is okay. Mr. Dawe?
I think it should take maybe less than a year. I think it should take maybe less than a year, because I think India has been able to sail through many troubles, and that too in a quick way, because the Indians are basically, I mean, very like,
and they say hope is not a plan, but understood 12 months.
No, not on a plan, but I think it's from the point of view as to how the stimulus has behaved. Okay. I mean, India's government has imposed 20 crores with 10% of the GDP. It should work well.
We are closing the session. Sukmani Sadana, your final word.
My question is, what's the prize? Who gets the prize, and how do we know when the game is over?
Prize is more work, more work for all of us. Smiles on our face, and our country doing well. And I say it on a serious note, because for the first time we realize we're all connected. Something happens somewhere.
Yes.
So if one person does well, everybody else does well. So if the economy does well, it collectively bodes well for all of us. So Sukmani Sadana, your sector coming back in 6 months. 9 months, 12 months, 18 months, when?
I would say for us to be exactly where we were before and to touch base with the economy that we had earlier, I think it's going to take about 1.5 years. Having said that, I think the silver lining that's come out of it is that I think it's brought everyone in the entire country together, this pandemic, in a very beautiful way.
Okay. All right. We've run out of time. As always, since we're doing this as a family, make sure you're checking out Business World Online. You are watching NewsX. You can find now Sukmani Sadana live on Instagram, hopefully shortly. And check out Shout Me Loud, which Harsh has been representing here. Unlu, which is a celebrity to fan connect platform. And of course, if you want to sue someone, then please call up Mr. Dave. Hopefully not us on the broadcast.
Capital. Why sue? It could be a transaction that involves raising capital.
Okay, I'm hoping I've said nothing controversial in this show. We journalists get sued a lot.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.